Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Second Shot by Cindy Dees, narrated by Alex Picard. Chapter 1. Helen Warwick stared at the glossy black door with its period-accurate brass knocker and kickplate. It was as carefully understated as every other door in this upscale Georgetown neighborhood, and screamed of wealth and privilege. Since when did her middle child become all of this? For that matter, when did Peter grow up? One minute he'd been a bright, charming child with no talent for sports, but a discerning eye for everything and everyone around him. And the next, he was an upwardly mobile gen whatever they were up to now, or with a live-in boyfriend, an art collection, a prestigious address, and a puppy. It was her fault, of course, that she'd missed so much of his childhood. She'd missed far too much of all her children's lives. But at long last, this was her chance to make up for it in some small measure. Retirement. Motherhood. She could do this. She lifted the knocker and let it fall. Leong, Lee to the family, opened the door immediately.
Mrs. Warwick, so good of you to puppy sit for us tonight.
She air-kissed him on both cheeks and held out a slightly singed apple pie balanced in her left hand. Housewarming gift.
Did you bake this?
He asked in genuine surprise, taking the pie as she set her purse down on the impeccable Louis XV credenza. I did. Eat it at your own peril. He laughed warmly and led her into the kitchen, where a small Renoir pastel casually filled a wall beside the refrigerator. It was the study for part of a more famous piece, but still, a work of art in its own right. Where the boys got the money for such things she didn't know and didn't ask. Of course, it didn't hurt that Peter was an art dealer in an auction house that sold antiques and fine art. But still, Renoir?
Don't you look nice tonight, Mother?
Peter said coolly, sweeping into the kitchen with all the style he usually did. He wore a crisply tailored black suit that was just shy of being a tuxedo. She'd agonized in her own closet for longer than she cared to admit, pondering what to wear to a puppy-sitting date. What clothing struck a tone of apology, commitment to building a relationship, and motherly love without sacrificing the cool sophistication she knew Peter cherished in all things? She'd settled on black wool slacks, a simple cashmere sweater, and a pair of black Italian leather stiletto-heeled bootlets that had to have cost more than her car. Thank God the agency had footed the bill for them as part of a disguise she'd worn a few years back at an Italian opera house.
You look dashing as always, darling, she murmured, air-kissing him as well.
When did her children stop actually hugging her anyway? Probably too many parental mistakes ago for her to remember.
Your mother baked us a pie,
Lee announced, to fill the silence already filling the chasm yawning between her and her offspring.
You bake?
Peter asked blankly.
Shocking, I know. Who would have guessed I was capable of mastering the domestic arts?
When Peter pulled a skeptical face, she added, Don't answer that. The silence crept forward again.
So, where's this new grand dog of mine?
She asked with cheer she hoped didn't sound forced.
He's having a time out at the moment,
Lee supplied, gesturing toward a custom wood crate with sliding screen front doors that looked like a piece of furniture. A small Calder sculpture was displayed on top of the puppy cabinet. Peter added in complete seriousness,
We got a little rambunctious earlier and refused to poop after our supper. Is that a group activity in your house?
She asked dryly. Peter rolled his eyes as Lee opened the large crate and scooped out a roly-poly blonde furball that was possibly the cutest creature she'd ever seen. She cooed in genuine adoration of the 12-week-old golden retriever.
Have you boys settled on a name for your progeny?
Lee and Peter smiled at each other and said together,
Biscuit.
Too cute. She reached out.
May I?
Lee passed her the squirming pup, who had a fat pink tummy, sharp little claws, huge bright brown eyes, and a black button nose. She held him up to gaze into his eyes. The little scamp stuck out his tiny pink tongue and licked the tip of her nose.
I'm officially in love, she declared.
Gee, if that was all it took, I'd have licked your nose years ago, Peter muttered.
Be nice, Lee murmured.
She absorbed the jab without comment. After all, she hadn't raised any of her children to be weak souls afraid to express their opinions. In that, at least, she'd succeeded as a parent.
What's the routine with young Master Biscuit? She asked. He'll need to go out once an hour on the hour, Lee answered briskly. Carry him into the backyard and put him down in the grass. Whistle until he potties. You can whistle, can't you?
Yes, dear, I can whistle.
Perfect. He goes to bed at 10. Put him in his crate and close the slats. He'll complain, but ignore him. He'll go to sleep in a few minutes.
He has already had supper and we're not feeding him people food, Peter added. So no snacks.
She sensed a grandmotherly rebellion forthcoming. It was clearly her job to spoil her granddog, and she wasn't about to shirk her duty.
Mother, Peter said warningly.
All right, already, I'll behave.
Not.
Lee took up reciting the puppy instruction manual to her.
We're staying for the fireworks, but should be home by 2 a.m. After bedtime, Biscuit only needs to go out every 2 hours. If he gets hungry, at midnight, you can feed him the snack I left in the fridge. It's in a bowl with his name on it.
What's in it?
Ground lamb, fresh pumpkin puree, scrambled egg, and rice.
This dog eats better than I do, she commented. Here is his gear drawer, Peter showed her, pulling a wide, shallow drawer in the puppy crate cabinet thing open. There's a harness, leash, thunder shirt, earmuffs for fireworks and other loud noises, teething ring, plush toys, and a spare blanket with his mother's scent on it. Emergency veterinarian's phone number is on this card, and text me if you have any questions.
He's a puppy, Peter. He eats, poops, and sleeps. How hard can he be to take care of? I didn't kill you, did I?
As if to make up for the dire look her son threw at her, Lee kissed her on the cheek.
Hang in there, he whispered as he leaned close.
She smiled gratefully at him for the vote of support. But she knew full well how far she had to go to rebuild the bridges with her family. If it was even possible. She and the puppy walked Peter and Leong to the front door and locked it behind them. And then it was just she and Biscuit. He gave a little whimper and she tucked him under her chin, nuzzling his silky soft fur fondly.
You don't hate me, do you, little nugget?
The boys had purchased 2 townhouses side by side and knocked out the walls between them, gutting and renovating them into a grand and gracious space. On the left side of the ground floor were a formal living room, dining room, kitchen, and breakfast nook. A long hall ran down the center of the house, and on the other side were 2 offices, a library, and a fully equipped home gym. A casual family room ran the entire width of the back of the house, with floor-to-ceiling glass windows looking out on the newly landscaped formal garden, an outdoor kitchen slash living room. The boys had only moved in a few weeks ago, but had already done wonders with the place. In her wildest dreams, she could never pull together a space this eclectic, chic, and achingly sophisticated. Maybe she could hire them to redo the house she nominally shared with Grace and Warwick, her mostly absent husband. She didn't want to think about that problematic relationship right now. Dealing with Peter's simmering resentment was enough for one evening. She dutifully took Biscuit to the backyard and felt like an idiot standing there beside him in the dark, shivering and whistling until he squatted and peed. Shaking her head, she scooped him up and carried him inside. Congratulations on successfully training your humans to make complete fools of themselves in 12 short weeks, my friend. Lee had thoughtfully chilled a crisp white wine and laid out a selection of old world cheeses and sausages for her.
Biscuit loved the cheese and sausage, and they reminded her of Berlin.
Good times in that cosmopolitan city.
She noshed on the snacks and sat down to watch television in the family room, where the massive flat screen took up an entire wall. She cruised through the channels until she found a movie.
Ah, Casablanca.
An oldie, but a goodie, even if the spy tradecraft in the film was dreadful.
Biscuit curled up beside her on the overstuffed sofa and settled down to sleep. 10 o'clock came and went, along with a potty check, but the puppy didn't wake. Common sense told her not to disturb the little guy. Rick told Louis he thought it was the beginning of a beautiful friendship, and the credits began to roll when she heard faint popping noises outside. She tensed sharply, and her gaze darted around the room. French doors to the backyard, kitchen entrance to the left, library entrance to the right, hallway in the middle. It had the best sight line to the backyard, but no cover. Sofa would provide visual cover only. That poker table could be turned on its side in a pinch to defend against gunfire. Better to head for the kitchen with its stone counters and solid wood cabinets for protection from incoming rounds. Oh, for the love of Mike. Stand down, Helen. It was New Year's Eve, and there was just some kids lighting off firecrackers in the alley. Whether it was the pop-pop-popping or her sharp reaction to it, she couldn't tell, but Biscuit jerked awake, lifting his head and listening alertly, his fuzzy little ears perked. Past time for a pit stop for you, young man. She carried him outside and set him down in the grass. The popping noises were louder out here. Amazing how much they sounded like gunfire. No wonder veterans had PTSD problems on nights like this. Apparently, she too was going to have to learn not to reach for a weapon whenever she heard fireworks. Her nerves were too on edge to bring herself to whistle. One did not call attention to oneself when bullets were flying. The dog showed no interest in voiding his bladder, perhaps because she refused to mortify herself with the whistling routine. Regardless, she picked him up and scuttled inside, eager to get undercover as yet another volley of loud pops erupted in the alley. This one was accompanied by raucous shouts and girlish screams. Kids. They had no idea how much their commotion unsettled people like her. It was almost midnight. She should cut herself a slice of pie and make a celebration out of her first New Year's as a retired person. That, and she would prove to the boys she hadn't poisoned their housewarming gift. She opened the drawers until she found one in the quartz waterfall island, with a built-in knife rack and a dozen chef-quality knives. She pulled one out, sliced the pie, and used the blade to scoop a piece onto a plate. A bright red glow flashed, and a second later, the distant thunder of the big New Year's Eve fireworks show on the mall began. Mindful of the puppy not being traumatized by the loud noises, she held him tucked under her left arm and dug around in the puppy drawer with her free hand. Now, where did your fathers put your earmuffs? The lights went out, plunging the house into darkness. Adrenaline surged through her veins unbidden, and her body went light and fast, ready for violence. What on earth? The clock on the stove and the touchpad on the refrigerator had also gone dark. Starbursts outside sent neon strobes of green, blue, and red through the black house. Her instincts fired off a strident warning, so insistent she couldn't possibly ignore the alarms shouting in her skull. Grabbing the pie knife, she dropped to a crouch beside the crate and listened tautly. All she heard was the steady, distant boom, boom, boom. Sheesh. Overreacting much? It was just a fireworks display. And she was a civilian now. Out of the game. Deafening automatic weapon fire erupted all at once. With an almighty crash, the entire glass-walled back of the house exploded inward. Glass flew everywhere as gunfire raked the family room. Crap on a cracker. Feathers filled the air as the sofa exploded. The glow of fireworks punctuated the attack, and wood and pieces of furniture flew every which way in the strobe-like flashes. Something hot and wickedly sharp sliced across her left arm with the neat precision of a scalpel. She knew that pain. She'd gotten winged by a bullet. Instinctively, she folded over the puppy, protecting his little body with hers. Fast roll into the puppy crate. Breathe in. Hold. Breathe out. A quiet crunch of a boot on glass. Another. A hostile was moving into the kitchen. Quietly, carefully, she tugged the blanket inside the crate around the puppy, wrapping him like a burrito, praying it would keep him quiet and still. Gripping the knife tightly, she waited in an agony of suspense for what came next. Legs came into her line of sight. Military-style boots, black cargo pants, leather thigh holster strapped down. A A few more steps. The gunman passed the crate. She rolled out and stabbed with all her might, burying the sharp blade of her knife in the back of the man's knee. He screamed and went down as she jumped and landed with both knees in the middle of his back. He was fast and strong and tried to roll over. He almost succeeded in throwing her off, but she hung on grimly as he rolled onto his side and then on top of her. He failed to trap her arms underneath him. She grabbed a handful of his hair, yanked his chin back, and slashed hard with the knife. The assailant thrashed on top of her, knocking her head hard against the floor in his death throes. She shoved for all she was worth and managed to roll him off her. She scrambled to her feet, blinking away the spots dancing in front of her eyes, her high-heeled shoes slipping and sliding in the spreading puddle of blood. In the flashes of fireworks, black blood welled from her attacker's mutilated throat. His hands fell away from clutching at the mortal wound, and she dived over him to snatch up his weapon, which had clattered to the floor. It was an urban assault rifle, Russian Ash 12.7. She dropped it into place against her shoulder and rested her index finger on the trigger. Pausing to kick off her high heels, she advanced fast and silent, knees bent, on stockinged feet. Odds were the other shooter was advancing through the far side of the ground floor. Crouching, she swung low into the hallway. Clear left, clear right. Using the tip of the weapon's barrel, she nudged open the half-bath door under the stairs. Clear. She heard a bump and a faint grunt in the library and raced down the hall on the balls of her feet, ducking into the dining room, listening hard for any more shooters than just the two. Then, the front doorknob rattled slightly, and she swore under her breath. A third hostile outside. Bastards must have planned to herd her through the house and out the front door into an ambush. By her recommendation, Peter and Leong had installed a top-notch German lock in the front door. If the guy out front thought he was picking it fast and joining the fight, he was sadly mistaken. Gliding into the formal living room, she cleared the space quickly and eased across the foyer into Peter's office. His desk was an antique, a massive wooden beast that would stop a small tank. Crouching behind it, she propped the barrel of the weapon on the writing surface and pointed it at the door to Liang's adjoining office. Exhaling slowly, she forcibly slowed her heart rate. Now, it was a waiting game. Then she heard a sound that made her blood run cold. Little claws scrabbling on hardwood. She swore silently. Biscuit had wiggled free of his blanket restraint. Little scamp was running through the living room. Did she shift her aim to the foyer on the assumption that the shooter would be drawn to the sound of the puppy? Or did she hold position, aiming at Lee's office? She had a split second to decide. Instinct said to stay put. In the very next breath, a black shadow spun fast through the doorway between the offices, crouching low, sweeping the office with his weapon. She double-tapped two shots at his center of mass, counting on the high-powered rounds to slam him backward against the wall and knock the breath out of him, even if he had on a bullet-resistant vest. The guy grunted and landed on the floor, leaning against the wall, but he was still functional enough to swing his weapon toward her. Adjusting her aim a hair's breadth higher, she squeezed off two more fast shots. The hostile's throat exploded in a fountain of blood, but the weapon jammed on her second shot, the trigger balking and refusing to pull through. Piece of crap Russian hardware. Her target toppled over and lay still while she rapidly considered her options. What she really wanted was her own trusty pistol, currently in her purse, sitting on the Louis XV credenza in the foyer. Laying down the Russian weapon, she eased out from behind the desk. But then the downed man across the room moved, so she bolted forward, darting back out into the foyer and out of range of any dying breath heroics. The front doorknob was turning. She dived for her purse, snatching at it as she sprinted past the table, searching frantically for Biscuit ahead of her in the living room. She missed the purse and only succeeded in knocking it on its side, the shoulder strap dangling just above the floor. But she couldn't go back. The door was opening. She lunged past it, scooped up the puppy, and dived for cover behind the sofa, landing hard on her shoulder, the one that had gotten hit in the initial attack. She lost her grip on the frantic Wrigley puppy, who rolled out of her arms. Crap, crap, crap. Peering under the couch, she saw the third hostile come in hot, charging into the foyer, aggressively swinging his weapon left and right. He raced down the hallway, his boots disappearing from her limited line of sight. Biscuit raced after him, running into the middle of the foyer when a new barrage of fireworks, as loud and insistent as an artillery battle, peppered the night. Underneath the deafening thunder of noise, she whispered urgently, "Biscuit, come, Biscuit." The puppy panicked and bolted straight ahead, ramming nose first into the credenza, where he yelped and promptly got tangled in the dangling shoulder strap of her purse. Frantic, he scrambled to free himself, to no avail. Terrified and completely overwhelmed, Biscuit squatted right there in the front hall and peed on the antique Aubusson rug. The pantry and wine room doors slammed open in the kitchen. Holding her hands out to the puppy, she tried again. "Come to Granny. Come, Biscuit." Perhaps her outstretched fingers still smelled like salami, or maybe he wanted a hug. But the pup, still tangled in her purse strap, stumbled toward her, dragging her purse off the credenza. As it thudded to the floor behind him, he lurched forward, dragging the purse behind him through the puddle of pee and into the living room doorway. He finally jerked free, but not before the shoulder strap fell within reach of her outstretched hand. She was out of time. With a shove, she pushed up off her belly, burst out of her hiding place, and leapt forward. Staying low, she scooped up the dog with her left hand and her purse with her right and bolted for the stairs. The shooter in the kitchen leapt out into the hall and fired wildly, sending a spray of lead into the wall below her feet. She ducked as splinters of wood pelted her and dived for the steps, fumbling frantically in her purse. Her fist closed around the familiar grip of her EDC X9 Wilson combat handgun. She didn't bother pulling it out of the bag. She rose to her knees and fired down at the shooter below through the leather of her purse. Two fast shots, one through the top of his head, the second through the back of his neck as he pitched forward, face down. A cloud of mist hung in the air where his head had been, illuminated by the now continuous flash of fireworks. She pushed to her feet, picked up Biscuit, and raced upstairs, tearing into the master bedroom. She paused inside only long enough to lock the door. Sprinting for the bathroom, she locked that door as well, stopping only when she jumped into the separate throne room, locked that door, and sat down on the floor beside the toilet, panting. Finally freeing her weapon from her ruined purse, she set Biscuit on the tiled floor and dug around in her bag for her cell phone. She dialed 911 as reaction set in, and her fingers began to tremble. "Go ahead," the dispatcher's voice said cheerfully. God, he sounded about 12 years old. She took a deep breath and reminded herself to sound like a panicked civilian. "You have to send help. There's been a shooting at the following address." She rattled it off. "Do you have anything nearby with a siren? Maybe it would scare the bad guys away." "Ma'am, those are fireworks you're hearing." "I've been shot. I think I saw 3 bad guys, maybe more." "Where are you now, ma'am?"
"Locked in the master bathroom upstairs."
"I've dispatched a police cruiser."
"Send all the police."
"Ma'am, if you'll tell me what's going on."
She interrupted impatiently.
"I told you, a gang of armed bad guys broke into my son's house and shot the place up. And they shot me, too."
"Where are you shot, ma'am?"
"In the arm."
"I've dispatched an ambulance. You should lie down on the floor until the medics arrive."
"It hurts like fire, but it's not bleeding a lot. I don't think it's serious. Not that I know a blessed thing about gunshot wounds," she added.
Her left arm was, in fact, burning as if a hot poker lay across her biceps.
Dang it.
Her new sweater was ruined, too. She tore off a wad of toilet paper and used it to dab at her wound. The hot lead must have partially cauterized her wound, which would explain the lack of profuse bleeding.
Who is this?" the dispatcher asked warily. "When are the police going to get here?"
She dropped her voice to a whisper, as if it had just occurred to her that the bad guys might still be running around the house.
"What if the intruders find me up here?"
"The first police cruiser will be there any time now."
Sure enough, a police siren became faintly audible. It rapidly grew louder until it was screaming outside the house. If that hadn't scared away any remaining intruders, nothing would. Thankfully, the police turned off the siren before long.
and deep silence fell over the house. The distant rumble of the fireworks continued unabated, heedless of the death and destruction going on below their star-spangled roar. She strained to hear any movement, but heard only her own breath and the puppy's anxious panting. Little Guy had been a champ, all things considered. Outside, police would be stacking up beside the open front door, diving in guns first, clearing the ground floor room by room. She heard them shouting back and forth. Reaction started to crowd forward in her body, a stew of mostly rage and a little fear. Who were the shooters? Why here? Was she the target? She was out of the game, off the chessboard. Why this, then? Who had it in for her bad enough to break all norms of civilized spy behavior? A male voice spoke up right outside the commode door.
Ma'am, are you in there? The house is secure.
What's your badge number? She demanded, pointing her pistol at the door. He was a hostile until he proved otherwise. He rattled off his name, rank, and badge number without any hint of hesitation. Her body went limp with relief. She stood up, her legs protesting as she unfolded her body from the cold, hard floor. Sharp needles of returning circulation made her wince. She picked up the dog, unlocked the door, and squinted into the beam of a high-intensity, military-grade flashlight.
Three men are dead downstairs, the cop reported, and it appears that a fourth one fled through the alley, perhaps on a motorcycle.
Four men? She should probably be complimented that such a big hit squad had been sent to take her out. Still, this wasn't supposed to be happening. She was retired.
Who else was in the house with you at the time of the incident, ma'am?
Nobody. It was just me and my granddog.
You shot those men?
The cop blurted.
Crud, crud, crud.
Speaking in a breathless soprano, she gasped.
I was so scared, officer. I just closed my eyes and pulled the trigger. Did I hit anything?
You could say so, the cop said dryly. Since you discharged a firearm that resulted in a death, we're going to need you to come down to the station, answer some questions, and make a written statement after a medic takes a look at your arm.
Of course.
She added a nervous, fluttery wave with her hand for effect. Although the pistol gripped in her fist probably ruined the helplessness of the wave.
You're sure it's safe out here?
She asked nervously as she stepped into the bedroom.
Yes, ma'am. The scene is secured.
The officer snagged her gun as she waved it past him, then checked the chamber and safety before saying,
This weapon will have to be entered into evidence.
With Biscuit still tucked under her left arm, she followed him downstairs to the foyer, picking her way cautiously through the splinters, broken glass, and puppy pee.
Is there any chance I could get my shoes? I must have run right out of them. I was so scared.
Wait here, ma'am. This is an active crime scene.
Keen observation, Sherlock. Careful to keep her eyes wide and wondering, she looked around the destroyed ground floor. It looked like a freaking war zone. As the cop held out her designer bootlets, she wailed,
Look at this mess! My son is going to kill me!
Chapter 2. Helen finally drove away from the police precinct at nearly 3 a.m. The police were unsure of what to make of her. On the one hand, they had three dead bodies shot with all the cold precision of the trained sniper that she was. But on the other, they had the flustered, middle-aged woman sitting in a chair in front of them, wringing her hands, adamantly sticking to her story. She'd simply closed her eyes and pulled the trigger in self-defense. Poor coppers just couldn't seem to reconcile the two. It had gotten a bit tricky to explain the knife in the back of hostile number one's knee, but she claimed that Biscuit had peed and the bad guy slipped in the puddle. As best she could tell, he'd grabbed at the counter as he went down, knocked the pie knife off the counter, and somehow landed on top of it, stabbing himself in the leg. Bad luck, that. She readily admitted to using the knife to cut herself a piece of pie, of course, which explained her fingerprints on the weapon. Her lawyer, whom she'd called from the foyer of Peter and Lee's house, met her at the police station. He argued stridently that the hundreds of rounds the intruders had fired made her armed response an open and shut case of self-defense. Eventually, without any hard evidence to refute self-defense in response to a home invasion, The police had been forced to let her go. But they didn't like it. They smelled a rat, but they just couldn't spot it. She made a mental note to avoid crossing paths with the Metropolitan Police of the District of Columbia, the Georgetown precinct in particular, anytime soon. She'd barely pulled out of the parking lot when her cell phone rang. Who could be calling her at this hour? Peter had already made his opinion abundantly clear of his brand new house being completely trashed on her watch. She doubted he would be speaking to her again this decade. At least she'd delivered Biscuit unharmed into Lee's arms. That had to count for something. The phone rang insistently. She transferred the call to her car's Bluetooth system and it showed no name on the caller ID. Frowning, she pushed a button and took the call. Hello? She said cautiously. Helen, Helen, Helen. What have you done? She sagged in relief. It was Yosef Mizra, her longtime CIA handler. He must be calling from a burner phone. Yossi.
How did you hear about tonight's excitement? I don't work for you anymore. I thought I was finally rid of you too, my dear.
She ground out. What the heck was that? They shot up my son's house. They can come after me all they want. I'm fair game, arguably. But the bastards came after my family. I want names. I want blood.
Metro police are saying it was a robbery gone bad. How about we figure out what happened before we jump to any conclusion?
She cut him off sharply. You and I both know what that was. Four men armed with Russian assault weapons who moved like a Spetsnaz team and shot out the entire back end of a house by way of entering the premises were not trying to rob the place. They were after me, but they didn't have the decency to wait until I was alone in my own home.
A long, suffering sigh in her ear.
I know. I swear to God, if the FSB is behind this, I'll make them regret even thinking about knocking me off.
I understand your feelings, Helen, but let's take a moment to find out who the shooters were. Collect intel on who sent them before you start a one-woman war with the Russian government.
They started it. And I won't take this lying down.
Let me find out who they are before you kill anyone else, okay?
She scowled fiercely. In her line of work, killing was an emotionless business transaction. But this was personal. And it involved her family. Still, a tiny voice of reason in the back of her head murmured that, like it or not, he wasn't wrong.
Who's the puppy I heard about at the scene?
He was blatantly trying to distract her. She let him, answering grumpily.
My granddog, Biscuit.
Only you can go through a firefight badly outgunned, outnumbered 4-1, with a puppy under one arm, and come out unscathed.
I suppose you're gonna need me to come into the office and make a report, aren't you? She asked in resignation.
Afraid so, but Monday will be soon enough. Take the weekend to relax.
I was relaxing. I was babysitting a puppy and having a piece of pie that I made with my own hands, I'll have you know, when poof, all hell broke loose.
Yosef was silent. The kind of silent that spoke loudly of him being as worried about this attack as she was. He too understood the unwritten rules that had been broken tonight.
Promise me you won't kill anyone else before you come see me.
She rolled her eyes, even though he couldn't see them. He knew her well enough to hear them.
Promise me, Helen.
Fine, I promise. No murders before Monday. I'll take the rest of the weekend off.
Nice shooting, by the way.
She snorted and hung up, without deigning to respond. Helen turned into her driveway, and the motion-activated lights came on around the house. She waited while the steel garage door opened before driving inside. She waited for the door to fully shut, and only then climbed out of her car. She unlocked the kitchen door and laid her hand on the biometric panel that deactivated the home alarm system. The network of red infrared sensor beams went off, and regular lights illuminated throughout the house. She went over to the kitchen island and dumped everything out of her pea-stained, bullet-ridden purse. Lipstick, spare ammo mag, perfume roller, fountain pen filled with a fast-acting neuroparalytic, powder compact, a wire garrote carefully wrapped around its rubber handles, and crumpled dry cleaning and grocery receipts that went every which way. Opening a kitchen drawer, she pulled out a 9mm Glock 43X she kept there in case of emergency. Chambering around, she carried it and the ruined purse outside. A quick sweep around the yard over the end of her weapon's barrel, and she laid her purse tenderly in the covered trash can behind the garage. "Rest in peace, you beautiful girl," she murmured over her purse's corpse. The wooded hillside behind the house was silent and still tonight, but she gave it another long, hard look anyway. The shooters had attacked her family. They'd had no way of knowing Peter and Lee would be out tonight. Outrage literally stole her breath away. How dare they? The quid pro quo was ironclad. "You don't mess with my loved ones, I don't mess with yours." She almost wished someone would move on that hillside. Give her a reason to go hunting and kill whoever wrecked her son's beautiful new home and almost offed her. A puff of wind stirred the cold air, and the trees waved at her eerily as her hair lifted from her neck. She lurched into motion and headed back inside the rambling two-story farmhouse where she and Grayson had raised their family. It reminded her of a well-worn sofa, overdue for new upholstery or a trip to the dump. But it was comfortable, and it was home. Her knees felt weak all of a sudden, and her hand shook as the aftermath rolled over her, flattening her in its wake. She was too old for this crap. Moreover, she was supposed to be finished with all of it. She was just starting to set aside the constant tension, the cautionary room searches, the roving gaze, the twitchy reflexes. But here it all was, roaring back, ripping away the gauze of normalcy with which she'd bandaged her tired soul, exposing the raw nerves of a killer once more. One last double check of the twin deadbolts and the steel-reinforced door with its impact-resistant glass, and she was safe. At least as safe as she could make this place without turning it into a straight-up fortress. Good grief. She didn't want to play this game anymore. She folded her arms on the cold granite counter and buried her face in them. For just an instant, she gave in to despair. It was a luxury she hadn't afforded herself these past 20 years and more. It felt good to let go of all the discipline, all the tension, all the constant vigilance. Maybe she should just hang it up. Let whatever might come her way, come. As soon as she gave in, even for an instant, she knew the indulgence for the mistake it was. Right now, her focus had to be on surviving. Not just for herself, but for her family. She had to figure out who tried to have her killed and take them out. Only then would her family be safe. Maybe then she could finally rest. Of course, she knew what Yosef would say. She could rest when she was dead. Tonight had been a close call. She allowed that knowledge to pass through her, became one with it. She'd gotten separated from her firearm. She'd left curtains open, lights on, made a stupidly easy target of herself. Worst of all, she'd gotten complacent, let herself be distracted by her family. Heck, she'd allowed emotions in. Brick by brick, she rebuilt the emotional wall around herself that she'd been working so hard to tear down. She locked away the budding feelings, put away her hopes for restoring her marriage and relationship with her kids. Maybe someday, she silently promised her husband and children. But not yet. First, sleep. Then a serious conversation with her former CIA handler. He had better come up with the names of those assailants, and fast. She was not on the company payroll anymore, and she had no compunction about going on her own to mete out a little jungle justice. She needed to know who'd ordered the attack on her, and why. What did he or she want? What would make them go away? Could a settlement be negotiated? Or was this going down old school? spy on spy, assassin on assassin, until there was only one man, or woman, left standing. She shoved all the stuff from her purse into a plastic grocery bag, plucking the spare ammo clip from the detritus of her attempt at normal life. She limped to the stairs. It felt as if the bottoms of her feet were cut up from running around barefoot on the shards of glass and splintered wood littering Peter and Lee's house. Muscles all over her body were sore from the violent activity, and her upper arm was hurting again. A medic at the scene had insisted on taking a look at it, and even bandaged it. But she'd lied through her teeth when he'd asked her if it hurt. She checked the security panel by the front door one last time. "Hello, Paranoia, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again." And trudged upstairs in her ruined stockings, bloody bootlets dangling from her left hand, pistol dangling from her right. Into the master bedroom. Solid wood door, locked. Steel painted to look like wood plantation shutters, closed. She exhaled in relief as her cocoon of safety locked down around her. She wouldn't let down her guard tonight. Not entirely. Not scant hours after someone had tried to kill her in the most emphatic possible way. But she could breathe in here. Stripping off the ruined sweater, she dropped it on the floor, slacks unzipped. She shimmied out of them and left them where they lay. Tomorrow was soon enough to throw out the bloody garments. The shredded stockings went in the trash with a certain satisfaction, and standing in her underwear, she stared at herself in the mirror. Her body showed the wear of bearing 3 children and 55 years of life. Much of it lived on the edge of danger. Some sun damage around her throat and on her arms, a few wrinkles creeping in around her eyes and mouth. Gravity was having its due here and there in the form of loose skin, but she was still lean and hard underneath. And she wasn't dead. Yet. By God. Her bun had given up the ghost at her first dive for cover, and her hair straggled around her face. Once naturally blonde, she'd faded to a dishwater color, somewhere between blonde, brown, and gray, which meant she got peroxide help now from a hairdresser in Northwest DC. She'd been looking forward to growing it out ever since she'd cut it all off 20 years ago. In her line of work, she couldn't afford to have it get in her eyes at exactly the wrong moment. A mistake like that could get her killed. But even growing out her hair would have to wait, apparently. Craning her chin to the left, she peeled back the bandage from her arm. The bloody stripe where the bullet had creased her was covered with a clear salve that had numbed the skin, along with providing antibacterial coverage. The cut was more of a scoop than a slice, the length of her finger, and shallow. Darn it. She'd been so looking forward to being a sissy in her old age and not having to deal with wounds like this. She replaced the large square bandage over the wound. It would scab over and heal soon enough. Probably would leave a scar. But it wasn't like she didn't have any of those. She took note of the thin one on her side where she'd nearly been gutted a decade back. Without seeing it, she knew there was a round bullet scar under her right shoulder blade and various small nicks and marks from other close calls over the years. She called them her teachable moments. Each scar held a valuable lesson for her. And so would this one. Never let down her guard. Ever. As she headed for the bedroom, ominous little aches announced themselves in her hamstrings and back, and both shoulders already pained her. She wasn't cut out for tonight's gymnastics anymore, and was definitely feeling her age. She winced in dread of tomorrow's stiffness. She took one of Grayson's big t-shirts out of his drawer, pulled it over her head, and crawled into their cold, empty bed. She reached for his pillow and hugged it close. Almost all the smell of his aftershave had faded from it. Would it be weird to buy a bottle of it and dump it on his pillow? He was somewhere in the Amazon jungle right now, crawling around on his hands and knees, looking for a new species of poison dart frog he'd gotten a lead on. Knowing him, he was as happy as a pig in mud. He loved his work as a naturalist fully as much as she'd loved hers. Past tense, damn it. She lay in the dark, staring up at the ceiling, replaying the events of the evening in excruciating detail, analyzing and parsing her performance, which, on the whole, had been pitiful. No doubt about it, she was out of practice. At the end of the day, she faced a cold choice. She could roll over passively and wait for the next attack to finish her off. Or she could pick her sorry derriere up off the ground and fight back. As much as she hated what she had to do, it wasn't much of a choice. If nothing else, she needed to stay alive if she was ever going to make up to her family for the past 2 decades. Her gaze narrowed in the dark. Somebody was going to pay for making Gray and the kids wait. That, and they'd scared her granddog half to death. Chapter 3. Ryan Getz jerked awake in the pre-dawn darkness, startled. Shoot. He dozed off. Urgently, he yanked his sleeve back to check his watch. If he'd blown his debut thrill kill by napping. A little after 6 a.m. Okay. Whew. Still a few minutes before go time. He peered through the high-powered Zeiss telescopic sight he'd duct-taped to the top of the industrial-grade laser cutter, which was basically a laser pointer on steroids. It was larger and more powerful than the ones people carried around in their breast pockets, but it operated basically the same way. A concentrated beam of laser light would shoot out in a straight line, passing harmlessly through glass, while poking holes through plastic, or a Mylar balloon. He glanced up at the half-dozen large gas tanks he'd hauled up to the roof last night. They still lay neatly beside the chimney, which he'd covered with plastic and taped to seal. Only he knew that a small pump had emptied all the methane from those tanks and into the house overnight. He panned across the back of the house and saw movement in the family room to the left of the kitchen. The family were early risers, were they? He hadn't planned for that. He didn't dare risk someone opening a door. It would release the highly flammable methane he'd so carefully built up inside. Drat. He hated going off schedule. No choice, though. Picking up his makeshift laser gun once more, he shifted the Zeiss sight back to the kitchen. The woman of the house was moving around the space, making herself a cup of tea and pulling ingredients out of the refrigerator. If she was about to turn on the gas stove, she would do the job for him. No. He got to make the kill. Not her. He shifted his aim to the bouquet and balloon he'd had delivered to the house yesterday. The woman, now moving around, had put them, ever so conveniently for him, on the kitchen table. The balloon was actually 2 balloons, one inside the other. The exterior balloon was filled with pure hydrogen. The interior balloon? Pure chlorine. Funny thing about hydrogen and chlorine. When they come into direct contact with each other, they spontaneously combust. And in a space saturated with methane and oxygen, well, he expected the results to be spectacular. He turned on the video camera and double-checked to make sure it was recording. Then he settled himself more comfortably and pressed the power button on the side of the laser. This particular cutter used infrared light, which was invisible to the human eye. A second, smaller laser light was mounted beside the primary laser that shot out a line of red light for aiming purposes. Indeed, a red dot danced on the house's exterior siding just below the window. It was too dark to see the black burn the laser would be making on the side of the house. Moving the weapon gently, he raised the red sight beam to the sill, then through the window. Laser beams were amplified light, and in general passed harmlessly through glass, unless they were high-powered enough to vaporize the glass molecules, which this cutter was not. He took a deep breath. His moment of greatness, so long planned for and anticipated, had arrived. Slowly, carefully, he raised the red dot to the New Year's balloon. The industrial laser instantly burned holes all the way through both balloons. As chlorine gas from the inner Mylar balloon escaped into the surrounding hydrogen, It ignited with a bright flash. The entire kitchen window momentarily filled with light as the methane-saturated air around the balloon ignited. Then the entire house exploded. Kaboom. The sound was deafening, and the brilliance of the blast was blinding. Heat seared his face, so he dropped flat, pressing his cheek against the damp, cold ground. Oh, man. That was spectacular. He panned the camera across the scene as pieces of the house and its contents began to rain down. He had all the footage he needed to craft the greatest thrill-kill video of all time. Grabbing the video camera and folding the tripod, he pushed up to his hands and knees and crawled backward the 20 yards or so beyond the ridge behind the houses. A great pillar of black smoke rose into the air, and the blackened skeleton of the chimney was all that was left intact of the house below. Welp, that should keep the fire department busy for several hours. Long enough for the remains of his cheap plastic tanks to melt into nothing, assuming any parts of them had even survived the initial blast. The methane had all been consumed in the initial explosion, and his innocent little mylar balloons had been vaporized. No fuss, no muss, no evidence. Chapter 4. Her doorbell rang far too early the next morning to be polite, and Helen looked up sharply, wincing as the muscles across the back of her neck screamed in protest. She glanced over at the iPad mounted on the kitchen wall and saw her eldest child, Mitchell, staring irritably at the video doorbell. He'd always been the most impatient of her three children, constantly demanding answers, insisting on understanding why everyone did everything. It made him a fine prosecuting attorney, but a bit of a pain in the butt as an offspring. She had no doubt Peter and her youngest, Janie, had elected him to come over and find out what the hell had happened last night. With a sigh, she put the pair of ice packs she'd been applying to various joints this morning in the sink and hoisted herself out of her chair, groaning as her protesting body creaked upright. She was fully as miserable today as she'd anticipated last night. Hobbling painfully to the foyer's wall-mounted tablet device, she brought up views from the cameras mounted on the corners of the house. The sides of the house were clear, no hostiles lurking out of sight waiting to rush the front door. She pasted on a smile, straightened her aching bones, and threw open the door. "Good morning, darling. You're just in time for breakfast. Can I make you an omelet?"
"Really, Mom? Pete's place gets blasted to smithereens and you want to pretend nothing happened and cook breakfast for me?"
"Why, I'm fine. Thank you for asking," she responded with light sarcasm. "I only have a minor flesh wound where a bullet creased me, and last time I checked, people still have to eat." She made sure to walk behind Mitch as he barged into the kitchen. He was too observant to miss how creakily she was moving. He sat down heavily on one of the bar stools at the island.
"You were shot? Why didn't anybody tell me that? Why didn't you tell me?"
"Because it would have involved me sharing that information with the police. It was only a flesh wound anyway. I cleaned it off and slapped a bandage on it. Ham, cheese, and green pepper, right? Still no onions?"
"Right, no onions,"
he answered absently. Abruptly, like the cross-examining assistant district attorney he was, he demanded,
"Who attacked you?"
"We don't know that last night was aimed at me. For all we know, it could have been an armed robbery, which I just happened to be there to foil. Your brother and his boyfriend do have a rather expensive art collection, and they don't exactly make a secret of it." Mitchell threw her a skeptical glare.
"Or it could have been someone trying to kill you."
She shrugged and busied herself whisking cream into the eggs and pouring them into a pan.
"Who wants you dead, Mom?"
"You mean besides your brother?"
"Be serious."
She turned, wielding her spatula like a pointer. "I am being serious. I don't have the slightest idea. What makes you think anyone wants to kill little old me?"
"I saw the police report. 4 armed gunmen, assault weapons, entry from both the front and rear of the house, nothing stolen. That sounds like a hit job, not a robbery."
He was undoubtedly right, but she wasn't about to concede the point. Her children had no idea what her real work had been. And if she had her way,
she would go to her grave with them in ignorance of it. Her cover had always been that she was a foreign trade specialist at the State Department. Oh, she admitted to working for the CIA from time to time, on loan from State, but purely as an analyst. The secret black ops, the off-books assignments, the blood in her ledger, none of that was ever spoken of. She laughed lightly, all the while adding fillings and folding the omelet in the pan. Honey, I'm retired. Who in their right mind would care about me enough to kill me? I analyzed trade deals and tariff legislation, not exactly the most exciting stuff on Earth. The day I retired, some poor schmuck took over my job exactly where I left off. I was a small cog in a very big machine. Skepticism flashed in Mitch's gray gaze. So like her own. But then it was gone. So fast she wasn't even positive she'd seen it. Surely she was mistaken. He didn't know what she did. It wasn't possible. She'd never breathed a word of it to him.
Still, you did work for the CIA sometimes.
Along with thousands of other paper pushers and desk jockeys. I'm sorry to disillusion you, but only a handful of CIA officers ever leave Langley, Virginia. And only a few of them ever do anything the least bit exciting, let alone dangerous. Television is not real, Mitchell.
Yeah, I got that memo, he grumbled. I'm an actual prosecuting attorney, remember?
How angry is Peter about the house? She asked as she plated the omelet and set it down in front of him.
He's incandescent with rage.
She winced. I swear, I was babysitting the puppy and minding my own business. And I would like to point out that Biscuit didn't get a single scratch.
Three men died in Pete and Lee's house. What do you know about that?
They must have gotten into a shootout with the SWAT team, she added innocently. Are there, I don't know, bloodstains? What a shame it would be if the new floors got ruined. Mitch snorted.
The floors are the least of the damage. The ground floor is completely trashed.
As she winced again, he tucked into his omelet. She sipped her tea in silence, trying and failing to think of an appropriate way to apologize to Peter and Leong for the carnage to their beautiful, brand new home.
Where did Peter and Leong stay last night?
She asked to fill the silence.
Grant's house.
Helen groaned. She was never going to hear the end of this from her mother. The woman took her role as family Harridan very seriously.
Mitch glanced up at her and shrugged. She was going to find out one way or another. Nothing goes on in this town that Gran doesn't hear about.
Truth. Her mother had been a fixture in the Washington political scene ever since her husband had come to her as a naive, starry-eyed young congressman from Indiana. Constance Stapleton knew everyone in Washington, and her gossip network was legendary.
Will you be seeing your brother in the next day or so?
She asked.
I'm going over there in a bit to help him make a statement to the press.
The press? She exclaimed.
You know the motto of the media. If it bleeds, it leads. It was quite the violent shootout, Mom.
Yes, I got that memo, she retorted dryly. I was there. Granted, I was locked in the toilet, hiding, but still, I heard it. Sometimes she really hated how easily she lied to her family. Mitch rolled his eyes at her. She said, quite seriously, please tell Peter and Leong they're always welcome here if they need somewhere to stay while their house is getting repaired. Although as the invitation came out of her mouth, she privately hoped they wouldn't take her up on the offer. Not because she wouldn't love to have them stay here, but because she wasn't sure they would be safe here. If those gunmen had been after her, it was entirely possible the next hit squad would be coming to this house. Mitch was talking again.
Ground floor is going to have to be redone almost from scratch. It'll take months. Turns out they're going to be able to get the apartment back that they stayed in during the first renovation.
Guilt rolled through her. Even if she hadn't done anything to directly provoke last night's violence that she was aware of. Silence fell between them, and she studied her eldest closely as he ate his breakfast. He was a good-looking man, with dark, wavy hair and light brown skin from her husband's half-African heritage. Cameras loved him.
He radiated poise, assurance, and most importantly to his political ambitions, honesty. In truth, Mitch was arguably one of the most calculating men she'd ever known, which was saying something given her former employer. She knew he aspired to political office, and she had no doubt he would end up in Congress or higher if work ethic counted for anything. She leaned a hip on the edge of the counter.
Did you only come here to ask me about last night, or was there something else you wanted?
How are you liking retirement?
No denial he had an ulterior motive. Her mama radar still worked like a charm.
I haven't been retired long enough to really know, I suppose. And with the holidays here, I've been too busy to slow down and enjoy it. Why do you ask?
I had a conversation with a defense attorney last night at a party, and it made me think of you.
How's that?
She could use the services of a decent analyst.
Why would a defense attorney be involved in a trade deal?
She's not. But you know how to read a complex report and translate it into a clear understanding of what happened.
Isn't that what you lawyers do?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.